right, happy Mother's Day to each and every one of y'all. Y'all look great. Let's stand up and sing. Number 189, if you want your book, Lily of the Valley. 189. Sing all three verses.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my savior. He tells me every care of him to roam. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 in my soul.
He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows worn.
In temptation
I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn.
From my heart and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me or Satan take me so, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 2,000.
All right, take a minute and shake each other's hands. Come back, we'll sing again.
So good to see you. And I do want to wish all of you a happy Mother's Day. And so glad that you're here. And ladies, you look beautiful today. And hope you have a wonderful Mother's Day. And also, look around, just enjoying seeing all the hats and everything. Y'all look great. Now, I want to mention this. After the service, if you'd like to be a part of a picture, if you got those who are wearing hats want to come and participate, see Miss Frieda after the service, and she's going to take a picture of everybody. And so just appreciate y'all participating.
I would have worn a hat if I'd known I was going to get my picture, man.
Well, you know what? I think I got a bandana. You can put a do-rag. There you go, right there. Right there. You know what? That kind of reminds me of something. This morning on the way to church, Angela started giggling, and she saw something on the, you know, on some of her social media stuff, and she says, "Dad, this is pretty funny." Yeah, she said, "There's no hood like motherhood, you know." And so You know, but I tell you what, I'm so glad y'all are here. And I'm looking forward to us having an awesome day as we just worship the Lord. But also, we just want to honor all you ladies and wish you a happy Mother's Day. And so glad that you're here. And I know we've got a lot of visitors with us. And if you're visiting with us, I do want to extend a very special welcome to you. And I hope that you take some time out and look in the bulletin, because there's a section of our bulletin love for you to fill out, just a guest registration section. So fill that out. We take up our offering a little later in the service. Just drop that in the offering plate. But again, so glad that all of you are here and looking forward to what God's going to do. But if you do have your bulletin, there's a few announcements I want to highlight. Y'all, there's going to be a baby shower for Miss Sarah McDatt Mullins coming up on Sunday the 19th at 2 p.m. So just to keep that in mind and just be praying for her. And also, there's going to be a brotherhood breakfast Sunday at 7:30, and so keep that in mind. And a few other things as far as some youth news, please realize that on Friday the 17th, there's going to be a mission opportunity for you to go and help out at a local food pantry, and so love for all of our young people to be able to participate in that. And also, any adults like to help out in that as well, that'd be absolutely wonderful. And also, as far as youth news, don't forget about Centrifuge Camp coming up. And there's going to be a meeting about the camp on the 26th. And so just kind of get some of the final details ready for all of that. But also something that is not in the bulletin that I do want to mention, y'all, and that is, since it's Mother's Day, and I know so many will be getting together and having family events and things, we will not be having evening services tonight. So no evening services tonight. So just enjoy this day and spend it with your family. And so just keep that in mind. And also, already mentioned this, but again, if anybody would like to participate in the picture after service, please do so. And you know, it is a special day, Mother's Day. And I did a few weeks ago just kind of mention, if you have a hat and would like to wear it, you know, wear it just to have a little fun, just do a little something different. But also, it really does symbolize something. And that is, there are so many different hats that as moms, y'all wear. And thank you for all that you do. And so we truly want to say, happy Mother's Day. We love you. And hats off to you, moms. So let's continue on in worship.
All right, let's stand and turn to 507. We don't sing this song about this time of year, but I like the words to it. You'll recognize the tune. It's a good song. Would you bless our home and families? Let's sing all four verses.
Chosen.
give me Jesus. The word will be on the screen. Come forward now, please. Jeff, would you pray for us?
Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you today for the blessings that you give us in life, God. God, preparing a place for us, Lord. We follow you and believe, God, that we can live with you someday. God, we just know that you're going to bless us today.
Thank you. video that we just want to show. And so if y'all go ahead and get that video ready and play it, that'd be wonderful.
Hey, Mom, I got these for you.
Mom, I got into state. Mom, she said yes. Mom, it's a boy. Hey, Mom. Love you.
Moms, we cannot thank you enough. And truly just want to say, we love you. We love you. We love you. You know, as I was just kind of getting ready for today, I was just kind of making a lot of different lists, I guess you could say, because, you know, with us having a little emphasis of hats off to mothers, I didn't want to kind of think about just some of the different hats that moms wear. But also, you know, I was just kind of making a list of all the mother figures in my life that the Lord has blessed me with, have an influence and have an impact upon me. But also just kind of making a list of a lot of moms we see in Scripture. So don't worry, I'm not going to hit all of these, but I do just want to just kind of mention a few. Because, you know, first, as we think about hats that moms wear, you know, I think about, for example, a chef's hat. I tell you, I think back to just some of the awesome meals that my mom prepared, or my grandmother prepared, or my beautiful wife has prepared, that the family comes around and just enjoys an awesome time of fellowship. You know, I think about a nurse's hat. Man, how many times has children had a little accident or something, a little boo-boo, and just had to come running to mama? And just funny how mama's kisses make it all better. Another hat that I thought of, a hard hat. Sometimes it's like a construction zone around your house. What about this? Anybody ever have to wear a referee's hat? Ever feel like you kind of caught in the middle of some siblings discussions, I guess you could say? What about a ball hat? Just either one, being at games, cheering your children on, or just being out and just playing and just enjoying time with them. What about this one? How about a cowboy hat? Uh-huh. Sometimes it's like herding cattle to kind of get people everywhere, isn't it? What about this one? A fireman's hat. Ever feel like you're just running around trying to put out some fires, moms? A policeman's hat. I'll leave that one alone. About like an army hat. And what I mean by that, if there's anybody that I want on my side fighting for me, it's my mom. And moms, thank you for fighting for your children. You know, thought about this. How about a chauffeur's hat? Anybody feel like that, having to, you know, tote a few around? Or how about this one? a banker's hat. Or I couldn't help it. I had to throw that in there because I feel like the bank of daddy sometimes. But I guess moms, y'all might feel like the same thing. But look, these are just some things that I was just sitting around just kind of thinking of off the top of my head. And look, and if there's some ideas that maybe you have, come let me know, because I like for this to be a growing list. And I know there's no way that we could be exhaustive here, because when I think about the mark that you ladies have upon our lives, upon your children's lives, upon your grandchildren's lives, look, you cannot put a price tag on it. I can remember years ago seeing like a little something that listed so many of the different things that mothers do. And if you add it up, let's say in the secular world doing these jobs, I mean, what mamas need to be paid for being mamas is probably close to $1 million a year or more. Out of all the work, out of all y'all do and everything, thank you so much for the impact that you're making in not only the lives of your children and grandchildren, but look, all who come in contact with you. And look, and I couldn't help but also, just in my own life, just kind of make a little list of the ladies that the Lord has put in my life that's blessed me. And the reason I just want to kind of share my list briefly is because I hope maybe it will kind of maybe encourage you and inspire you to make a list of your own. And if you do, I ask you to do something. If you're so blessed to have a sweet, precious lady in your life that's still alive, reach out to them, love on them, and let them know how much you love them, appreciate them, and how much they're a blessing to you. But you know, but for a lot of us, we may have loved ones to go on and be with Jesus. And y'all, let's take time and let's thank God for those precious lives He blessed us with. So my list, it starts out with my mom. I'm so thankful for my mom and all that she has done for me, and how she is there for me, and how much she loves me, even whenever I was unlovable, if y'all can believe that. I can't help but to think and thank God for my Mama McDowell. This is my mom's mom, and I was thinking back to a funny memory this morning, because she was one who wasn't afraid to get out and play ball with me. And I can remember just getting old enough to really kind of swing a bat and hit the ball kind of pretty good. And she got out in the yard with me and tossed me a ball, and I hit it so hard, and it came right back at her. And I was so surprised how that little old granny was so quick, she dodged that ball. I mean, absolutely amazed me. But I just remember my mama, and just so thankful for her. You know, I think about my grandmother Fair. Praise the Lord, I still have her, and I look forward to calling her today right after the service. Just let her know I love her and just appreciate her. I can't help but to think about my Aunt Dinah, who's my mom's older sister, who is pretty much like a second mama to me. Just think about times as a little kid, how she would take me places and teach me things and just constantly just love me. You know, not only people that I've been blessed with to grow up with, but y'all, I had a wonderful opportunity to marry into just a wonderful family. And I tell you, I inherited from Courtney, one, her mom, Myra, just a wonderful, beautiful mother-in-law. And the way she just accepted me in and just loved me, man, I'm so thankful for her impact upon my life. And also, for example, Courtney's grandmother, my mom, Joyce, the way she just loved me and cared for me and was there for me and loved me as her own. And I'm so thankful for my beautiful wife. And look, so much of my mother-in-law and my grandmother-in-law's characteristics, y'all can see how my beautiful wife has turned out. And so much of it's because of the influence that they've had on her. Y'all, I am so blessed to have had so many beautiful ladies that the Lord has put in my life to impact me, to love me and care for me. And look, and I thank the Lord for my mom, but also I thank the Lord for all mother figures that he has put in my life. And then also I think about this. Out of every church that I've been able to be at and pastor, y'all, I've had sweet ladies in the congregation who've been mother figures to me. And as I look out around here, I've had many of you are like that. So I praise the Lord and thank him so much for you. And so, look, with all that being said, moms, we love you. Man, thank you for the impact that you have had and that you continue to have. And I want you to know that the job that you do, it does not go unnoticed. And you are so loved. And look, and I was thinking about this. It is tough being a kid today, growing up in the world that we live in, because there are so many things that are just at our fingertips, especially for young people, to be a distraction, to be led astray with, and so much. It's tough. And if it's really tough to be a kid in this day and time, a child growing up in this day and time, I want to tell you, it's tough being a parent in this day and time. To be able to love and raise our kids to seek the Lord and to serve him and to instill in them character and spiritual disciplines and love for the Lord, to be able to stand up against the grain that the world has, that we may be examples for Jesus Christ. And look, I hope and pray, look, all of us do, we want our kids to grow up and be good citizens. Oh, my lands, look, if we do that, we feel like, yes, we're doing good. But I just want to challenge you all, let's take this a step forward, because we shouldn't just want our kids to grow up and be good citizens. We should try to help them and instill in them a desire to grow up and be world changers for Jesus Christ. And I mean, the influence that we have, especially, I mean, parents, but obviously moms and dads. But, you know, we're thinking about moms here this morning. To raise our kids to be world changers for Jesus Christ. And look, and so, since I was making a list of different hats that moms wear, and also the ladies in my life that the Lord has blessed me with to impact me and to love me and to encourage me, I couldn't help but also make a list of some moms that we see in Scripture. For example, I think about Eve, the first mom. Now, I want to tell you, it's great to have an example to follow, but you know what? She was number one. She didn't have an example to follow. And so we think about Eve being the first mom who blazed a trail of motherhood. But also, I couldn't help but think about Sarah. You know, we're going, for those who come on Wednesday nights, we're having a study looking at the life of Abraham, and to think about how Abraham, who's the father of the faithful, look, Sarah, she's the mother of the faithful. And also to think about a Jochebed, and actually, we're going to look at her this morning. Some of you may think, who in the world is that? Well, that was Moses' mom. And we're going to dig into her story in just a little bit. But also, I think about Hannah, who was the mother of Samuel, who wanted a child so bad, and whenever she was blessed with one, she dedicated him to the Lord, and he ended up pretty much being the last of the judges. And the Lord used him in a powerful, powerful way. I think about Elizabeth, who was a mom of the forerunner of Jesus Christ. How the Lord used her. And I think about Mary, the mother of Jesus, who God saw in her such integrity, such character, someone who was willing to lay it all on the line for the service of her heavenly Father, the mother of Jesus. And also, I can't help but also think about in 2 Timothy, in that chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, whenever Paul is writing to Timothy, and encouraging him and challenging him, but also says you need to be thankful for the influences of your mother and grandmother upon your life. Lois and Eunice, how they were spiritual influences to help that young man to become the man that he was. And so look, there are so many examples, there are so many things, but I want to say this one thing before we dig into the Word. Y'all, life is tough today. It is tough. And I alluded to the fact that it's tough for kids growing up, but also it's tough being a parent today. And I do just want to kind of just kind of step out on this as well. Y'all, it is so tough being a mom today. Because I think about in the times in which we live, and we do live in a different world. That here's the thing. All the traditional stuff that moms have always done through the years, guess what? Many of you so feel like that still is expected of you to do and carry out. But not only that, we live in a time where so many not only have to focus on being a mom, but y'all, for a lot of households, if it wasn't for also for mom working, families couldn't survive. And so not only do you have like a full-time job of motherhood, you also have a full-time job of something else. And I want to tell you, so many times I can only imagine how that feels so difficult, how that is so trying, how you feel like the work never ends. And I can only imagine how that can weigh on so many of you. I want to tell you, we love you and thank you for all that you do. And one thing that the Lord put on my heart to say is this, that you are wonderful, you are beautiful, and you are fearfully and you are wonderfully made in Jesus Christ. Please know that. Please know that. And we just want to stop and say we love you and thank you for all that you do. And whenever you feel like there might not be enough of you to go around or to offer or whatever, please let me just encourage you with this. You know that the Lord, He is your strength. He is your everything. And He will give you what you need to do what He has called you to do. Man, we love you. And so I want to just look here in Exodus chapter 2. Because I want to look at one of these moms that I mentioned. We want to look at Moses' mom this morning. Because I want to tell you, I sense a lot of parallels of what we see here in Exodus to really kind of what we face in life today. Because when Moses was born, he was born into a time whenever God's people were in Egypt. And y'all, and they were slaves in Egypt. They were in bondage. And it was tough and it was difficult. But not only that, the Egyptian people felt threatened by the Hebrews. And you know, and isn't it funny today that we live in a time where it seems like tolerance is preached everywhere. And the world wants everybody to be tolerant to everything. But isn't it funny whenever people stand up for godly principles and stand upon the word of God, that is one thing the world and society does not seem to tolerate. And that's where we live in. We live in a world where people feel threatened by God's people. And so they want to hold them down, push them down, just be quiet. Fine, have your Christian faith, but don't be bringing it out in public. And that's the thing. God tells us to not hide our light of Jesus Christ. We need to let it shine. And so I see here that the Egyptian people are trying to put down the people of God. And look, and this is something else that really blew my mind when I started thinking about it. It is crazy. It is crazy how in our society we have people, and please don't get me wrong. I love animals and I love nature, okay? But there is a problem when people seem to put more emphasis on the lives of animals and more emphasis on the lives of trees and not emphasis on unborn babies growing inside a mama. There's something wrong with that. And I believe that is so of Satan and so of the devil. And I think about, on two occasions, Whenever God is getting ready to raise up a world changer in a particular time period, I think about Moses. And what did Pharaoh want to do? He wanted all the male children to be thrown in the Nile and killed. Now fast forward a little bit whenever Jesus was born. What did Herod want to do? He wanted all the children, boys under the age of two, to be executed, to be killed. I really feel like Satan is threatened by the generation that's coming. And he knows that God wants to raise up some mighty leaders. And what is one thing that he's trying to do in our day and time? So many babies are being aborted. I want to tell you, that is of Satan. And I feel like it's because he feels threatened on what he senses. And he knows what God is wanting to do. Y'all, we live in important times, critical times. I mean, kind of hanging in the balance, world-changing times. And it's important for us to stand up for the things of God, to be witnesses, to show love, to show compassion, but also be bold and stand on the truth. And I see an amazing example of a mama here in Scripture who does some amazing things. And it's really, in this passage, there's three things I just want to pull out. And obviously, it's Mother's Day, and so I'm talking to you moms, but also these principles that we see here are really for all of us, daddies too. And not just moms and daddies, but all. But let's take a look and see what Scripture says. In Exodus chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, it says this: Now a man of the house of Levi married a Levite woman, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. First thing I want you to see here, and look at and Moses' mom, Jochebed. Look, her name is not even mentioned here in this passage. We find it out later on, but something beautiful that this lady does, and I mean, moms, I want to challenge you with is this: that if we want to raise world changes for Jesus Christ, it is critical, mamas and daddies, grandmamas and granddaddies, that we do exactly what she did, and that is, she protected her child. She protected her child. That whenever society said, you know what, get rid of that baby, what did she do? She hid that child. She protected that child. And it said here, she protected him, hid him for pretty much as long as she could, for 3 months. You know, and that in and of itself is a miracle of God. That a child could be good for the first 3 months, you know? And she could be able to protect that child. And so the Egyptians did not know that this child was even alive in this world. And so it's important for us as parents, y'all, that we protect our children. And I want to tell you something that scares me to death. As a daddy, I cannot be with my kids 24/7. And there are so many things that every day on the way to school, when I take the kids to school, I always pray for them. And one of the things that I pray for them is, Lord, protect their eyes, protect their ears, protect their minds, protect their hearts, protect their bodies. Put a hedge of protection around them, Lord, as they go to school. Because I know good and well there are things that they face, they see, that they are exposed to, that I cannot protect them from. And so what I pray is, God, where I cannot do it, you do it. Well, I have to trust you in that. You do it, Lord. But what I do have control over, and y'all, this is something. Y'all, we do have control over what comes in our homes. And I want to tell you, I feel like at times I got to do a better job about that, about what we watch on TV and so forth. But look, we got to protect our kids. We got to protect our kids. And so that's what Moses' mom does. She protected them. And so here's the thing. I think it's so important that we realize we cannot shelter our kids. We can't shelter them, but we can protect them. We cannot hide them away, because here's the thing. The Lord does not want us to hide away, does He not? Doesn't He tell us not to hide the light under the bushel, but we are a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden? And look, we need to realize that. We need to protect our kids, but we need to prepare our kids to go out into the world and to be the light of Jesus Christ. And that is critical. It is critical. Yes, protect them. Protect them. But not only that, something else that we see here that Moses' mom, that she does and that she has, y'all, she has a plan. She has a plan. Because we just read part of the plan that whenever Moses got big enough where she could not conceal him, she got a basket, fixed the basket up where it could float. She put him in the basket, put him in the reeds, got the sister, put him in the reeds of the Nile and kind of get him to go. And then the sister followed along to see where the baby went. Look, she had a plan. And now, to kind of see the rest of this plan, pick up with me over here in verse 5. It says, "Then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the riverbank. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent a slave girl to get it. She opened it up and saw the baby. He was crying, and she felt sorry for him. 'This is one of those Hebrew babies,' she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, 'Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?' 'Yes, go,' she answered. And the girl went and got the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you.' So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, 'I drew him out of the water.'" Now picture this. Moses' mom realized that she could not hide him away forever, that she was going to have to let him go. But her plan was, I want to put him in this basket, and you, big sister, follow him. Now think about this. Look, in my mind, I think Jochebed knew that Pharaoh's daughter often went down to this particular area to bathe and to get refreshed in the Nile. And so whether it was her plan, obviously, it was God's plan to get Moses right there at that time. They see the basket. They go and see it's a baby. And what do you know? Big sister shows up and says, "Hey, do I need to go to get someone to care and nurse this baby for you?" And so she goes and gets her mom. And think about how awesome this is. How God is working in and through this. How here is mama, loves her child, wants to protect her child, realize he's a fine child, and God's got great things in store for him, but now is going to get to raise her baby boy. And not only that, let me tell you the blessing. She's getting paid to do it. Now, is God not good or what? I mean, really. I mean, think about that. Pharaoh's daughter gives a thumb up saying, "This little baby's going to be protected. He's going to be mine one day." And so Jochebed is able to care for her baby, to love him, to teach him. So what we see here, she protected her child, but also she had a plan. And it is so important, parents, that we have a plan. Parenthood is too important and too critical just to wing it. We need to have a plan. You may say, "Well, I don't really know what that means." Look, sit down, pray about it, and think of what God may want to do in you and in your family. Think about ways, for example, to spend time together. Spend time in God's Word. Spend time in prayer. Look, have a plan. Set some goals. Do some things. Now, I want to tell you, in saying that, I don't want you to think that I got it all figured out, because this is an area that I still struggle, but I see the importance, and I want to strive to try to do more of within my family. Look, we've got to have a plan. Got to have a goal. Got to have things to shoot for. And really the best thing is not just for us to sit back and try to think up some stuff, but the best thing is to go to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, give me some direction. Lord, give me the plan I need for my family. So look, she protected her child. She had a plan. But not only that, I believe she instilled in Moses a sense of potential, purpose, and destiny in his life. Because, you know, it kind of goes to a big jump here because, it says over here in verse 10, when the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, I drew him out of the water. So we know that in the early formative years, Moses' mom cared for him, loved him, raised him, taught him. But then when he got to a certain age, carried him into Pharaoh's household. Now we realize that we know this, but then look at verse 11. It says, one day after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people were and watched them at their hard labor. Now I want you to think about this. How did Moses know that was his people, the Hebrew people? I believe it was because his mom taught him about the Lord and about who his people, who they were. Now, when you read the rest of the story, Moses steps out and he does some things that he shouldn't do. He ends up getting angry and ends up committing murder, killing somebody, and then all of a sudden he flees, and so he's away for some 40 years as God is working in his heart, helping him to become the man that God wants him to be, to live out his full potential and that purpose and that destiny to be the one who goes up into Pharaoh's court and says, let my people go. But I want to tell you something. For Moses to get to that point, I think so much of it was what his mom instilled in him when he was a young boy. This purpose, his potential, his destiny that God has for him to carry forth and to do. Y'all, it is so critical, mamas and daddies, that we instill within our kids. Let them know that they are created for a purpose, that they have unlimited godly potential within their lives, and God's got a destiny for them, a plan for them, that he wants to use them to change this world for Jesus Christ. I want to tell you, moms and daddies, we need to speak this more into the lives of our children. We need to do that. We need to fan that flame within their hearts. That God has created them more just to go through life, just to be good boys and girls, just to be good citizens, just to be good people, and then one day die and go to be with Jesus. We need to teach them, help them to realize that God's got a purpose and a plan, and he wants them to leave a mark on this world that's hard to erase. That God wants to use them to be great in his eyes, to live for him, to worship him, to live a life that goes against the grain of what the world says to do, and to usher people into the presence of God. Look, I truly believe that God wants each and every one of us to make a difference. He did not just save us to beam us up when we die. He's got a purpose and a plan for all of us. And look, and I'm telling you, parents, it's important for us to speak this purpose and potential and destiny into the lives of our children. But I want you to see something else. That I feel like it's my job to speak it into all of you. That it doesn't matter how old you are, or how young you are, or what your background may be, or what you may have done, or what you have overcome. I don't care if you're 2, I don't care if you're 102. God is still working on you, and he's got a plan for you. And I want you to know, being the child of the King, that he's got potential in you that he wants to draw out. He's got a purpose in you that he wants you to live out. And he's got a destiny for you to be carried out. You are loved. You are cared for. And look, and as much as you love your children and your grandchildren and you want good things for them, I want to tell you something. The Heavenly Father loves you and he wants good things for you. And the greatest thing for any of us to do, y'all, is to live faithfully for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Look, I know life can be tough, life can be hard. Man, there, I was kind of joking around about this with somebody earlier today, that there are times that I just stop to kind of catch my breath in life, and I'm thinking, where's all the time gone? It's like if it wasn't for pictures that I have, I wouldn't remember certain events in my life. It's like there's big gaps of like life, like where did it go? And so it's flying by. We know that. And I know what a lot of you are thinking. You ain't seen nothing yet, preacher. Okay, I get it. But I want to tell you something. The time that we do have left, it is a gift. A beautiful gift. Let's not waste a second of it. Let's live it all for Jesus. Let's make the most of our family opportunities, our family gatherings, our friends, the people we come in contact with. Let's be mutual encouragers of each other to help fan the flame of Jesus Christ in each other's hearts. And y'all, let's be world changers for Him. You know, moms, I want to tell you something. I love you, and I do hope you all have a wonderful, wonderful Mother's Day. And I know some of you may be thinking, well, Brother Rusty, I'm not a mama. Well, I want to tell you, you're a mama to somebody. All of you are. Because when you love and you care for and you influence, you may not have children of your own, but I want to tell you, you're a mother figure. And we need to thank the Lord for you just as much as anybody else. But let's don't waste a second. Let's protect those that the Lord has put under our care. Let's have a plan, and let's instill that purpose and potential in their lives. Let's trust Him and do everything we can to honor Him and lift Him up in all that we do. And when it's all said and done, I pray all of us stand before Him and hear those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant," that we can look back on our lives and that we leave such a ripple effect that we influence far more people than what we just see. But y'all, we impact eternity. Let's let it start today. Let me pray for us. Older Heavenly Father, I love you. I want to thank you for this time, Lord, to be in your house. Lord, I thank you just for all the ladies in our lives that you have blessed us with. Lord, thank you for the mamas. Thank you for the mother figures, Lord, and I honor them today. Lord, I pray that they will feel special. I pray they'll feel beautiful. I pray that they will feel fearfully and wonderfully made in you. And Lord, I thank you for them. And Lord, I just pray that you will help us as husbands and daddies and brothers and just men. Lord, that we will just encourage the sweet ladies that you've put in our lives. And Lord, that we'll help them to be their very best for you. Lord, I pray that you'll bless our time of commitment and invitation. And Lord, if there's any decisions that need to get made, I ask you to give us all the courage and strength to say yes to you and whatever it is. Lord, if there's someone here that needs to get saved, may it happen. If someone needs to rededicate, Lord, may they do so. Lord, if whatever commitments you put on their hearts to say yes to, help them to do it with boldness and courage. And Lord, and I just do a mighty work during this time. I love you and I thank you for all blessings. And above all, thank you for Jesus. Help us now. We love you. In your whole name we pray. Amen.